I'll tell you about a study that rocked the world of psychology and psychiatry studies. I'm sure some of you experienced an at least mild version of a mental disorder. Actually, I was diagnosed with anxiety and panic disorder once. An ER doctor, who was not even close to be a mental disorders expert, made this diagnosis. I remember thinking, so this is it? Is it so easy to be diagnosed as mentally ill? Then I came across this study I will talk about. That was the aha moment for me. I know it's way better than the past, but as you all know, it's disturbingly too common to see someone to be easily diagnosed with a mental disorder without required extensive examination, like it's a very regular disease, such as flu.
And then you haven't got the guts just to walk out. I mean, what do you think you are, for Christ's sake, crazy or something? Mm-hmm. Well, you're not. You're not. You're no crazier than the average asshole out walking around on the streets, and that's it.
And a 1973 study called Being Sane in Insane Places by David Rosenhan profoundly altered the way the world looked at the fields of psychology and psychiatry. Nothing was the same in these fields after this groundbreaking study. The study, also called the Rosenhan Experiment, is believed to be one of the most striking studies in these fields so far. With this experiment, Rosenhan wanted to find out if it was possible to pinpoint a person with a mental illness, which means if people were diagnosed correctly. He believed there were significant issues in this process, and he wanted to prove that the criteria used did not match scientific facts. Let's talk about how he conducted this experiment. 8 people checked in a mental hospital saying they heard voices. These 8 people included 3 psychologists, a pediatrician, a psychiatrist, a painter, and a housewife. The 8th one was David Rosenhan himself. None of these people had any sign of mental disorder, and they never heard any voices. But at this stage, only at this stage, they lied. Just once, because for the sake of the study's reliability, they would act completely normal if they were to be accepted to the hospital. This is where things start getting really messy. All of these 8 people were accepted to the hospital with the suspicion of mental disorders. And starting from day 1, all said they no longer heard voices, that they were okay, but none got released. But Rosenhan wanted to see where things would go and did not declare that it was an experiment. In the end, all 8 of the patients got released, but the minimum stay was 7 days and maximum was 52 days. A person with no disorders whatsoever got treated with serious medication and therapies. You think this is nuts, right? Wait for it. Things get more and more ridiculous. All these patients got released with a diagnosis. We're not talking about a mild anxiety here. You know, patients especially said that they heard voices, the words such as empty or hollow. Rosenhan picked these words on purpose, as these types of words are believed to indicate a type of existential crisis. Alright, so 7 of these 8 people were diagnosed with schizophrenia and 1 with manic depressive psychosis. People with no mental disorders got to learn that they had schizophrenia. So these people were released, but this tells us that the doctors were not convinced that they were not cured, but their schizophrenia was in remission. Based on this, Rosenhan concluded that it was commonly believed that mental disorders were impossible to be terminally cured. As if you tell a patient that you're in remission, it means that person is not totally cured. I mean, you don't release a patient with cancer saying your cancer is in remission, right? If the patient is cured, you congratulate them and wish them luck. So, in this system, if you get a mental disorder once in your life, you get to live with that forever. Everybody went nuts after Rosenhan announced the results of the experiment. They said Rosenhan was a fraud and he tried to deceive the system on purpose. That wasn't it. Many mental hospitals and clinics around the country challenged him. They claimed that they could tell the real patient from the unreal one at a glance, and they wouldn't fall for this trick. Indeed, one hospital contacted Rosenhan and asked for fake patients to be sent over. They were pretty sure they could easily notice the fake ones. According to them, the cases in the experiment were just coincidental. and such cases would never happen in theirs. And Rosenhan accepted this challenge. He said he would send them fake patients in indefinite times without letting them know. After a while, the said hospital made a public announcement, and they said that they suspected 41 of the 193 patients applied to the hospital in the last 3 months did not have any disorders, and 19 of them were definitely not ill at all. But you know what Rosenhan did? He made an announcement after this and said he never sent them any patients.
God damn, chief. And they all think you're deaf and dumb. Jesus Christ. You fooled them, chief. You fooled them all.
People they did not accept to the hospital probably had real mental disorders. They were real people, not fake patients sent by Rosenhan. At this point, the world of psychology and psychiatry just gave up. And Rosenhan wrote this: "It's clear that we cannot distinguish the sane from the insane in psychiatric hospitals. But what can be said of the 19 people who were suspected of being sane by one psychiatrist and another staff member? There's no way of knowing. But one thing is certain: any diagnostic process that lends itself too readily to massive errors of this sort cannot be a very reliable one." There's one more striking side of the story. In the first part of the experiment, some real patients at the hospital suspected that the group of pseudo-patients sent by Rosenhan were faking their symptoms. To be more specific, 35 out of 188 told some of the group that they could not be really insane. "You're not crazy. You're a journalist or a professor. You're checking up on the hospital," patients claimed they were told. Hospital staff, however, never noticed that they were pseudo-patients. In conclusion, the Rosenhan experiment succeeded to leave its mark on the psychiatry world for good. After the study was published, the American Psychiatric Association changed the diagnostic and statistical manual of mental disorders. Also, Rosenhan's experiments contributed to the reforms at the psychiatric hospitals, and the idea of releasing a patient started to become more acceptable for the medical staff. To me, one of the most fundamental results of this study is this: diagnosis of people with wrong mental diseases gives me the idea that thousands may have experienced this wrong diagnosis. And we all are aware of the public impression towards mental diseases. When someone is diagnosed with a mental disorder, everybody around them starts to act accordingly. Whatever they do is attributed to their disorders, and no one tries to help. You might say that this is a good thing. I mean, when you know what's wrong with you, life might get easier. When you say, "I'm bipolar," you know what to do and you get the required treatment. I totally agree. But as Rosenhan's study tells us, when this diagnosis is not correct, you have to live with this all your life, and you will be the one to suffer the consequences. Just imagine, what would you do if you were diagnosed with cancer, even if you don't have a cancer? See you next week on the same day. Bye!